Hi, this is Steve Bartlett. It's awesome to have you dial in and tune into what we're doing again today. This is lesson number 4. Hopefully you got your manual by now so you can take some good notes and really pay attention, learn these principles, because they're going to really help you a lot. In this lesson, I want to teach on what is probably the most important thing of all in evangelism, and that is really inspiring people to believe. You know, it's amazing. I can walk up to someone who doesn't have any faith in God at all, and literally in a 5 to 10 minute conversation, steer their attention and steer their focus onto God's creation, onto their own need for a Savior, present the gospel to them in such a way, literally 10 minutes later, someone will believe that 10 minutes earlier didn't believe. The truth is they never really thought about it and they were never directed in the right direction. So again, let's take some time today and study one of the most just incredible principles. Now think last week, I told you that there were 4 truths or revelations that stand head and shoulders above all the other ones. Let's take just a second and review those because this lesson's based on those. The first one is creation. The first revelation God gives mankind is that in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. This is where all of our evangelism starts. The realization that there is a God that created the heavens and the earth. The second great revelation that God gives mankind is that we fell, that we literally died in the Garden of Eden. God said to Adam, the day you eat of it, you'll surely die. Because we didn't fall over physically dead, most of us think, well, we really haven't died. Well, you really have. You're spiritually dead, and you need to be reborn. That's the second great revelation. Through deception, Satan has become the god of this world. Mankind is now dead spiritually, and we need a Savior. That brings us to the third great revelation, and that is this. God's solution to our sin is the blood of His Son, Jesus Christ. Again, today, the reason I mention all these things is because how you inspire people to believe is you use these great truths, these great revelations, and to drive them home in someone's heart. And I'm telling you, they're going to go from not knowing about God to believing someone created the universe to not knowing if they really need a Savior to realizing I really do need a Savior. And then they're going to go to the point where they realize that Jesus alone has paid the price for their sin and can save them from their sin. And remember the fourth revelation we talked about last time? It's so simple. God doesn't make the decision of where you go. He leaves it up to you. Each of us is an eternal spiritual being. We were created in the image and likeness of Almighty God. The Bible says that God has set eternity in our hearts. That's Ecclesiastes 3:11. Show me anybody on this world, sooner or later, they're going to ask the question, isn't there more to life than just this life that I'm living right now here in this physical world? And the answer is yes. We're created spirit, soul, and body. And all three parts of mankind, Jesus came to reverse what happened to us in the Garden of Eden. I tell you, it's great news, and if we'll learn how to inspire their faith by using these great revelations, and I'm going to add 2 more things that are going to help you get effective in inspiring people to believe. See, the real goal of evangelism is to win someone's soul, but to do that, I have to inspire them to believe in God, to believe that they need a Savior, to believe that Jesus is the Savior, and to make the decision to call out to Him. You know, literally this week here at the Bible College, I've been asked by students that are very comfortable going out and talking with people and beginning to share their faith. And they keep asking me the same question. I've already heard it 5 or 6 times this week. Steve, how do you close the deal? How do you get someone to really call out on the name of Jesus? Well, listen, today's lesson is all about that. And again, I'm giving you about a half an hour synopsis of exactly what these lessons are all about. And if we were in a church setting, or I was in a Bible school or a coffee house, I might take an hour to really explain and teach each one of these. But for our purposes today, again, I just want to hit the highlights of this and give you a synopsis of the main truths and main points. And again, I encourage you to get a manual so you can take some notes and do some interaction. If you'll work through this material, I literally guarantee you to become much more comfortable and effective in sharing your faith. Well, again, let's talk about the very first thing, creation. How do we use creation to inspire someone to believe? Well, again, we talked about it last week, but I want to reiterate it today. The Bible says in Psalm 19 that the heavens declare the handiwork of God. This tells us that when I get someone to just simply look at the stars at night, to look at this universe that we live in, to look at the beauty of God's creation, that it is going to literally point them in the direction of God. We find the same thing here in Psalm 97. Listen to this. The heavens declare his righteousness, and all the peoples see his glory. If the people will just lift up their eyes and look at this creation that we live in, the beauty of a sunset or a beach or the stars or just any of the miraculous creation that we see around us every day. I'm privileged to live up here in Colorado next to Pikes Peak. It's amazing when we look at the mountains. I'll go down to Manitou or Colorado Springs, and I'm talking with someone on the park bench, and they're telling me, well, they're not really sure if there's a God or not. I'll just simply point out the mountains, and I'll say, take a minute and look at this beauty. Look at this creation. Are you telling me this is an accident? And you know what happens over and over and over again? They say, no, obviously, something is behind this world that we live in. Something's behind our very lives. Well, that something is Almighty God. And I want you to know that the real truth here that I want to get across is this. My job is to get them to really look at creation and ask the question, where did it come from? You see, what God has created will take care of itself. What most people don't do is think about where it came from. Think about the fact that it means there's a creator. I think last week I used the illustration of my watch, and I said, how many of you believe this watch created itself? Man, I love to ask someone, are you telling me that with everything that we see in this universe, the stars, the vastness of space, the literal privileged position that Earth is in, the exact miles it needs to be from the sun, tilted at the perfect angle, and to have life, the perfect temperature range for life, and this is an accident? You know, people don't really believe that. What I've discovered is most people have never been directed to really think about it. So this is how I'm going to inspire faith. I'm going to make them think about where this universe came from. And let me say this to you. If you'll start, I mean, if someone already believes in God, you don't need to start with creation. But this is the beginning of our gospel presentation. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Listen to Paul in Acts chapter 17, and this is his statement. God, who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, doesn't dwell in temples made with hands. Could you imagine that? What's the first thing Paul wants them to learn? These Greeks that he's ministering to, there's a creator, and no temple on earth is going to house him. He's bigger than the earth. He's bigger than the universe. He belongs to a different realm. God is spirit, and everything that's created is temporary and physical and natural and literally is going to just be rolled away the same way that you and I would take off a shirt and just throw it in the dirty clothes bag. This whole physical creation one day is literally going to be cast aside, and God is going to have this new heavens and a new earth. And don't get too, you know, far with them when we talk about that. That's between me and you. I want you to know everything you see in this world was created by a loving God for a specific purpose. And if you'll unleash creation, if you'll let people and guide them to think about where we came from, creation will do its own preaching, its own teaching. Creation is revelation. Unleash that revelation into human hearts, and they will believe that there is a creator that's behind this. I have several teachings you can find on the internet where I go into great detail about how to use creation to inspire faith. But again, today I just want to hit the highlights. Now, the second way we inspire faith is actually embedded into the hearts and minds of every person on earth. And it goes right in line with the second revelation that we find in the Word of God. Do you remember the second revelation? That Adam and Eve sinned and literally died in the Garden of Eden. Now listen, as a pastor, I did everything I could to try to help people overcome a sin consciousness. Because if they have a sin consciousness, they're literally walking around in guilt and fear and condemnation. They're afraid of God. That's not how God wants any of us to live. But listen, until we realize we have sinned, we're never going to realize our need for a Savior. And listen, the goal is not to condemn people. It's to activate in their heart a sorrow and an awareness that they need to repent. You know, the Bible teaches two things, and again, it's here in your outline. I don't have a lot of time today to really cover all this, but it is the goodness of God that leads men to repentance, and it is godly sorrow that leads men to repentance. And the reason I say this, if you just ask a person, are you perfect or have you ever sinned? I'm not going to talk about Adam and Eve's sin so much. I'm not going to talk about the church's sin or the religious hypocrite that they met when they were a kid's sin. No, the only thing that matters is my sin and their sin. And my question I ask to people all the time, have you ever sinned? What do you think I hear literally 99, probably 0.9% of the time? Well, of course I've sinned. We've all sinned. And the thing is, we know in our hearts we've sinned. And see, this is the second great revelation. Adam died in the Garden of Eden. His sin has cut himself off from God. And this is why God sent his son to be the savior of the world. You know what? All Christians, all Buddhists, all Hindus, all Muslims, all atheists have in common. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Think about that for a minute. This is true about every man, woman, boy, and girl on this planet. Do you have to teach little Johnny to lie and cheat and steal? You know, the first time that I guess I was ever aware, I got a spanking. I was about 4 years old because I stole gum from my grandmother's purse. That wasn't why I got the spanking. What do you think happened when they caught me with a huge wad of gum in my mouth and they said, Stevie, where did you get that? I said, I found it. They said, did you take it from her purse? Oh, no, I found it. You know why I got a spanking? Because I'm lying about being a thief at age 4. Now, let me tell you something. This is true about all humanity. And see, instead of me condemning them about their sin and calling them a sinner, you know what I love to do? I like to say we've all fallen short. I needed a Savior as much as you do today. Again, if they understand there's a Creator, and then you ask them, are you living a perfect life before a holy God? You know what they're going to come to the realization of? That I do need a Savior. You got two options. Try to save yourself through legalistic living perfectly. How well do you think that's going to go? By the works of the law, no flesh shall be justified, because by the law is the knowledge of sin. It's a rough thing because God never wanted to put man under the law, but it was the law that showed us that we need a Savior. You know, it still works today. I run into people every weekend. If you look on our website, you'll see a calendar of events where we have all kinds of festivals and outreaches that are planned. We're going to be all over the world. And I want you to know something. The reason I go is because I know every single person I run into realizes there's a God that created the heavens and the earth when I simply draw their attention to that. And they also realize that they need a Savior because we all know that we've sinned. And I've listed here in your outline several great passages of Scripture. The Bible tells us there's none righteous, no, not one. You know, I don't want to just pull that verse out and beat someone over the head with it. That's not why God gave us that truth. I mean, if you read the whole thing where it says, for all have fallen, sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, the very next verse says, then we're justified freely by His grace. It's not that we want to harp on people's sin and hammer them with their sin, but the truth of the matter is, no one's going to admit and realize their need for a Savior until they realize that they've sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Now that brings me to the third great revelation, and that is this: Jesus Christ paid the price for my sin. How do I inspire them to believe? I get them to look at creation. I get them to examine their own heart. And then you know what I do? I just unleash the gospel message. You know, the Bible tells us that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. If you will preach what Jesus Christ did on the cross, that preaching of the gospel will literally inspire them to believe in Jesus. Until they realize there's a Creator, until they realize they've sinned, it doesn't make sense to go up and tell someone, hey man, Jesus loves you. Well, what on earth does that mean to someone who doesn't realize that they need a Savior and that Jesus alone paid the price for the sin of the world? You know, the truth is, guys, we have the greatest message that has ever been given to mankind. And I'll tell you something, and I mentioned this before, T.L. Osborne taught us this years and years ago. The world wants what I've got. A loving Savior who cares and will listen to their prayer. And if I'll just simply unleash the gospel message, if I'll preach Jesus' birth, His life, His death, His resurrection from the dead. Again, I've listed all this to you. The clearest passage in the entire Bible that defines the gospel is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, where Paul actually says, this is the gospel that I preach to you, that Christ was let me just read this to you. I deliver to you, first of all, what I received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture, that He was buried, that He rose again on the third day, and then He was seen by Peter and seen by the 12, and last of all, as a man born out of time, He was seen by me also. And again, this breaks up into a very simple outline. Christ, the fact that God got off of the throne and put on flesh and blood. Who is this Jesus? He's not a normal man. He's not just a good teacher. He is God in the flesh. And that's what it tells us in John 1:14. The Word became flesh and came and lived among us, walked among us, came down here on earth. God got off the throne. He cares so much that He put on flesh and blood and came down here. That's who Christ is. Christ died for our sins. Why did Jesus go to the cross? It's amazing. He knew if He went to Jerusalem, they were going to kill Him. And yet, what does the Bible say? He set His face to go to Jerusalem. Jesus deliberately went and was crucified. He gave His life. They didn't take it from Him. My goodness, could you imagine what Jesus could have done if He wanted to use His power and authority to get out of going to the cross? He deliberately went to the cross to pay the price for our sin. And the Bible says He was buried. There was 3 days that He was in the tomb. No question about it. He died for our sins. He was buried, but God raised Him from the dead. You see, it's all about Jesus and what Jesus did. And listen, this is what I've learned in more than 30 years. I think I'm on 33 years, literally, of evangelizing literally all the time. We go out. We might miss a week here and there, but that's because I'm training somewhere or something. What I want you to know is if you'll unleash the gospel, people will believe and people will get born again and it'll make sense to them. Preach Christ, preach His death, His burial, His resurrection. And then lastly, and this is something that's a little bit different, we're eyewitnesses. Peter was an eyewitness. Paul was an eyewitness. Steve is an eyewitness. And so are you. What is your story, your testimony that you could add to this? Again, if you look at your outline, you'll see that's my fourth real point. I'm an eyewitness. You know, in 1982, I was a drug addict and an alcoholic and an unbeliever. I was living with a girl at the time, and Jesus made Himself real to me. When I put my faith in Him, all of my life changed. I was born again, born of the Spirit. I repented of my sins, and I turned to Jesus. Those are the two real steps to conversion, to turn in repentance from your sin and to put your faith in the Lord Jesus. I have a testimony. Did you know that I tried to quit getting high and doing drugs? Listen, I had a full college scholarship and I was on the tennis team at Texas Tech University and I never could get my act together. I never quit getting high, never quit getting drunk, never quit doing all kinds of stupid things. Guys, in one day, God gave me the power to change my entire life. It's exactly what the Bible promises. In John 1:12, the promise is to as many as receive Him, to them He gives the power to become the sons of God. You know, I haven't been high or messed up or whatever you'd want to call it in more than 35 years. God, in a moment, gave me the power to change my life. Now, see, that's my story. That's what I know about God. That's what I can tell people when I meet them in the parks and on the streets and in the bars. Listen, are you tired of destroying your life? I want to tell you what God did for me. Now listen, if I lead them to the realization that there is a Creator, and I bring them to the awareness that they've sinned and they need a Savior, and I preach what Jesus did, that God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in Him would not perish but have everlasting life. If I preach what Jesus did, how He gave His life a ransom for many, and then I testify about what God has done for me, you can see what's happening. They're gonna have in their hearts just literally faith begin to rise up and say, wow, man, God did that for you. Maybe God would do that for me. You know what I love so much about my testimony? I'm not telling them about something that happened 2,000 years ago. I'm telling them something that happened right now in my life. Let me real quick just tell you, 4 years ago, I had stage 4 cancer. And when I go in to see the doctors say, Steve, what are you going to do? Now, how do you think that would be for building your faith when the doctor looks at you and says, you waited too long, man. What are you going to do now? Let me tell you something. When you pray in Jesus' name today, the same miracle working power that we read about in the Bible, we see today in our very lives. You know, I'm completely cancer free. And you know why? Because of the power of the name of Jesus. What the doctors can't do, God can do, and God will do for you. See, that's my story. And that brings me to the last part of this, and that's miracles. Do you understand that we can lay hands on the people, and they can get a miracle from God? What do you think that's going to do for their faith? Man, I've had some miracles that have resulted in more than 100 or even more people getting born again because they see you beyond a shadow of a doubt. I've listed just a few of them here. Down in the Dominican Republic a few years ago, a guy whose jaw had completely degenerated, where he had to wrap a towel around his head to keep his jaw up in the place, he got a brand new jaw. And what do you think happened to all the people on that street that knew this man? That next day, we had 87 visitors from that one street. Think about that for a minute. One miracle settled the issue for so many people. What inspired them to believe? Was it my gospel presentation? Was it my testimony? Or did they see the miracle working power of God? If you and I will lay hands on the people, if we'll prophesy over them, if we'll move in the gifts of the Spirit, if we'll heal the sick right on the streets. In Spain one time, a man whose ankles had completely collapsed was instantly healed, and it resulted in literally the whole church filling up in a matter of a month. Let me tell you something, guys. If we'll simply do what the Bible teaches, we will inspire people to believe. Think about this. Creation preaches the awesomeness of God. The fall of man even shows people their need for God. If we preach the gospel and what Jesus did on the cross, people will believe. If we can add our testimony to that, and then actually move in the miraculous. Do you understand? You can inspire people to have faith in the living God. Again, I just hit the highlights of our study here today, but I want you to know the same way that I inspire people to believe, you can inspire people to believe. And without sounding, bragging or whatever, prideful. Let me just say this. I have sat on park benches, gone to beaches, gone out into the streets, and literally led thousands of people to Christ, inspiring them to believe with creation, helping them to understand how critical it is personally for them because of their own sin and their own guilt, and their own fear of God, which shouldn't be that way. But until they have a Savior, how else are they going to think? Preaching the gospel and unleashing what Jesus did. Man, I've listed here in your manual dozens of verses that explain the gospel message, how Jesus Christ gave his life a ransom for many. He paid a price you and I could never pay. And if I'll add my testimony and what I've personally witnessed in my life, and then literally demonstrate the healing power of God. I've cast devils out on the street where right in front of a crowd of people, others immediately put their faith in Jesus. You can do the same thing. God's given us the power to inspire people to believe. Well, again, these are the highlights from class number 4. I hope you'll take some time and study this and realize how easy it is to win people to Jesus. God bless you.